morning, Bridgepoint family. Today is November the 6th, the first week of November. That's why it's getting burr. So to remove the burr, please stand and rise and let's go and give this room the warmth that it needs and give the glory to the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen? Amen. And I wanted to let you know that this first song is audience participation. Okay, I will be watching you. So the guys will be singing with me, and the girls will be singing with my lovely sister Rocky. Let's see if you can do it. Amen? Amen. Amen. Let's go.
You are you who gives me strength. Nothing is impossible.
Focus on gratitude, because there should always be an attitude of gratitude. And we have to thank the Lord for so many things. But today our songs focus on the cross, on the big sacrifice that he's made. And I have a few verses that will help you embrace the songs. James 1:17, every good gift and every perfect gift is from above. coming down from the Father of light, with whom there is no variation or shadow due to change. Thus, he is unchanging. He is always the same. And we just want to thank you from the bottom of our hearts for all he has done. Sometimes in our busyness, we take it for granted. We have so much. We have a car. We have 5 meals a day. But always keep in mind, without him, we are nothing. So let's focus on giving him the glory that he deserves. Amen. Thank you for your kindness. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you for the cross. Thank you for the price you paid. Thank you for salvation. Thank you for unending grace. Thank you for your hope. Thank you for this life you gave. For there is no one like you. There is no one like you, God. Oh, my hope is in you.
We worship you, Lord, this morning. And this morning, Lord, we would like to look at the cross. Lord, the cross, the reason why you died, Lord, is because of us. You prioritize us before your Son, oh God. And we cannot thank you enough, oh Father. We cannot thank you enough, Lord. Lord, we worship you, Lord, this morning, and be glorified, Lord, in our praises today.
Glory fills the highest place. What can
Let's be seated as we pray. Lord in heaven, we thank you this morning for giving us this day where we can come and just offer to you songs of worship. And even where words are not enough, we are able to lift up to you our hands and our gaze. And we're grateful for the chance to be here in your house today. All week long, you have given us reason to praise, both in times of victory, but also in moments of testing and difficulty. We choose to worship you and honor you, not because of what goes on around us, but because you are always worthy. And when we worship you, we are expressing to you trust. We are putting in you our hope. And we are sending a message to those around us that our highest call is to give you worship and honor and praise. So this morning, take all that we have given to you. Many of us may have come through a difficult week, and yet we're here because of your grace. And there are those who have experienced great victories, joyful moments, celebrations of success, all of which are a result of your work in our lives. And together, O God, we just lift up our voices to you. And even as we sit and prepare to listen to your word, we pray that it will be spoken in a way that challenges us, that comforts us, but also moves us to rely in your spirit to give us all that we need so that we can obey and we can live out your word for your glory. And throughout this week, Lord, give us opportunities to be ministers of the gospel, to be ready to share a word of hope, to lift people up, to encourage one another, all for the glory of our Savior who has done all these for us. Thank you for this moment. And thank you for this time of ministry. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. And amen. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Good to be here at Bridgepoint today. It's always a privilege and a joy to be in God's house. And we're glad that you have taken the time to join us. Well, if you followed us the last couple of weeks, you know that we are studying a very short letter in the Bible. It is known as the second letter or the second epistle of Paul to Timothy. And we've been at it for a few weeks, and I should be done by the end of today. We are going to look at the last chapter of 2 Timothy. If you have your Bibles, you can open with me to 2 Timothy chapter 4. You can leave it open in front of you. We will read the entire chapter by the time this is over. But for now, let's just focus on what God has to say to us, and we're grateful for the word that he has given. We know so far that Timothy is the recipient of this letter, and the relationship between the writer, Paul, and Timothy, the recipient, is a very tight one, is a very close one. In fact, Paul calls Timothy my son, my son. It really doesn't get any closer than that in terms of an older minister and a young pastor who's beginning his ministry to call someone your son. It kind of reminds me of my mentor in ministry, you know, Pastor Babes from Seattle. Pastor Babes and Sister Nikki don't have biological children. They just never have been able to. And yet, whenever you talk to them, they proudly declare that they have children all over the world. There are many pastors today and serving in Europe and all throughout Asia and here in North America and Canada who are a product of their ministry and their work of discipleship. And if you go to Pastor Babes and Sister Nikki's house today, on the mantle of their living room are pictures of all their children. I'm there. But when you look at that and you ask, who are these? They'll tell you, these are our children. These are our sons and daughters in the faith. And that's how tight the relationship is when you can call yourself a son or a daughter. But here's how I want you to frame your thinking today so that you will appreciate what we're about to read. And I've asked this question at the very beginning of the series. I'll ask it at the very end. If you knew that you had one last day to say something to someone you love, what would you say? If you knew that you would not see tomorrow, that when the sun would go down this evening, that will be your last sunset, and you will go to sleep tonight and you're not going to wake up in the morning, and this is your last chance to say to someone that you care for, listen to my words, what would you say? I often think about that. You know, this sounds morbid, but every now and then when I close my eyes at night, I always ask myself, what if this is my last time to close my eyes here on earth? Have I said enough to my children? Have I expressed to my wife who's sleeping next to me what I really feel, what my thoughts are? And my greatest fear is that one day I will be correct, it will be my last, and I have failed to express to them the very things that is in my heart and that lays heavy on my mind. Well, Paul's not going to let that happen because Paul has an advantage, and the advantage is he knows that this is his last letter. He knows that being imprisoned for the second time in Rome, that he's not going to get away with it this time like he did the first. He knows the charges against him, and he knows that the punishment for the charges against him is certain death. And so he writes this letter. He probably takes the last pieces of parchment that he has, whatever ink is given to him in the prison. And I often wonder, by the way, what accounts for the length of letters in the Bible? Some letters are 16 chapters long. Other letters are like just a page. And it struck me one day, and I said to myself, maybe what determines the length of a letter is how much paper the writer has left and ink. Because if they had a lot of paper and a lot of ink, I think they would just keep writing and writing and writing and writing, wouldn't they? But if you only had so much, if Paul was only given this much parchment, and they said, here's a feather and here's some ink, but that's all you get, then Paul has to be very calculating about what he will say in these few pages that he can write. And he was probably down to his last sheet of paper. And he's going, I'm never going to write another letter after this, so I better make this count. And that's the chapter we are going to read today. His last letter, his last chapter, his closing words before he faces his demise. So let's read the passage together in 2 Timothy chapter 4. And what we will learn from this passage are the final words of instruction that Paul is going to give to his young apprentice, after which he will entrust Timothy to take over in the ministry from there. So the first set of instructions are found in verses 1 to 5. And in essence, I summarize this by Paul saying to Timothy, number one, I want you to know, be a faithful shepherd. Be a faithful shepherd. Look at verses 1 to 5. Paul said, I charge you in the presence of God in Christ Jesus, who is to judge the living and the dead, and by his appearing in his kingdom, preach the word. Be ready in season or out of season. Reprove, rebuke, and exhort with complete patience and teaching. So the first thing he tells Timothy is, you are a pastor. One of your primary responsibilities is the preaching of the word. And he says, because you are a pastor, you do not have the prerogative to decide when or where you will have an opportunity to preach. You have to be ready always. You know, when I was in seminary, there are two kinds of seminarians. There's those of us who anticipate becoming pastors, and then there's those of us who anticipate becoming traveling preachers. You know, us pastors, we feel, well, we're going to be stuck with one church for a long time. And the traveling preachers, they visit different states, different countries, different this and that. And we pastors would often joke with our evangelist friends. We would say to them, have you written your 5 sermons for the year yet? Because when you're a pastor, you have to produce a minimum of 50 sermons, 52 sermons, because you have 52 Sundays with your congregation, not counting your Wednesday studies, not counting your outreaches, not counting your hospital visitations, not counting visiting people who are shut-ins, et cetera, et cetera. You could have a library of 200 sermons by the time the year is over, and our traveling ministers, they just have to have 5 sermons and just keep preaching the same thing over and over whenever they travel. So it was sort of we would tease one another, you know, in seminary about that. And Paul was being kind to Timothy when he said, Timothy, you're not a traveler like me. You're a pastor. You're going to stay with that congregation for a long time, for as long as, you know, you're called, as long as you're needed. People ask me all the time, they said, Pastor Ed, you've been with Bridgepoint 30 years. How much longer are you staying? I said, I have 2 indicators. One is, how much can I still stand? And number 2 is, how much do the people still want me here? Because if one of those 2 goes, I'm gone, right? I'm not going to stay any longer than any of us want to be around. But the mindset of a pastor is, you're there for as long as God will have you there, right? And I can't keep preaching the same 3 or 4 sermons over and over and over and over again. You always have to search the Word. You always have to look for a fresh understanding, a fresh perspective. And Paul said to Timothy, I want you to preach the Word, but be ready in season and out of season. In other words, whenever the opportunity comes, you don't have the choice to say, I'm not ready. And I remember I was hanging out with Pastor Chito and Pastor Vino a couple of weeks ago in New Jersey. Pastor Chito is in LA now, but he used to pastor in Cebu. And Pastor Vino is in Seattle now, but we used to travel together, and one time we visited Cebu. We were there for vacation. Unfortunately, Pastor Chito saw us in the airport. And when Pastor Chito sees you, he'll already schedule you to preach from the airport. And he saw us coming out of the plane. He was there to pick someone else up. And he said, oh, I'm glad you're here. He said, come with me. Now, if you have to know Pastor Chita to understand this story. He doesn't always know where he's going. So when he says, come with me, that means we don't know where he's going either. He said, I have a plan. That's a dangerous line from him. So he drives us a couple of kilometers to a beach. And I'm going, wow, a beach! Finally! No work. This is a beach. Well, it turns out that he had some members who were having a retreat in the beach, and he wanted us to teach a Bible study to them. He didn't tell them we were coming. He didn't tell us we were going to show up. They were swimming in the ocean. And then he goes, Pastor Chita goes, you, come out and sit here, and one of these brothers will teach you something. That's it. That's all he said. And then we looked around. Vino and I did not have Bibles with us. And I go, Pastor Chita, our Bibles are in the luggage. And he pulls out his Bible. He goes, here. And immediately, you know, we look for a passage. We pastors, we sometimes have our, you know, when we open our Bibles, it normally just opens in our most preached page. That's how the pages work. And so I found something. I worked the sermon in my mind for about 2 minutes while he was buying time. And then I taught a Bible study in the beach with people drenched in seawater, wrapped in towels. And I remember this instruction, be ready, be prepared to preach whether you are ready or not, in season or out of season. That's just how ministry works. And then he said to them, for the time is coming when people will not endure sound teaching, but have itching ears that they will accumulate for themselves teachers to suit their own passions. Why should you be faithful as a minister? Why should you be faithful as a pastor? Because somebody has to hold the fort, because a time is coming when people will no longer want to listen to what is right. People are going to pick and choose who they want to listen to. And by the way, if you haven't noticed that, the time is now. There was a time in world history, and even American history, that you had no choice but to listen to your pastor every Sunday. That was it. Y'all remember Little House on the Prairie? There was just that one minister, right? That old man with white hair. If you wanted to hear a sermon that Sunday and you lived in a little house on the prairie, he was the only preacher you would listen to. No YouTube, no other churches for miles. You had to go to that one church and you had to listen to that one pastor Sunday after Sunday after Sunday after Sunday. You would have no reason to compare him with other preachers. You couldn't tell if he was a good preacher or a bad preacher. All you knew is that he was a preacher, and he brought the word. You fast forward to today, it's much harder. Because now you wake up, you go, should I listen to Pastor Ed today? Or should I just YouTube church? There are better preachers out there. There's more amazing visuals out there. You can watch a minister halfway around the world from the comfort of your own home. It's harder these days because people have all these choices and it's harder to capture the attention of people. Now, we pastors have a choice. We can either keep preaching the truth, or we can alter our message to keep appealing to an audience to guarantee that they will keep coming back. And the problem with that is you resort to gimmickry rather than sound doctrine. And many preachers have fallen into that trap. We are so insecure about losing listeners that we will do anything and everything to get people's attention. You know, there's this guy I would follow sometimes because he really goes through extremes to keep his congregation coming back. One day he did a sermon on spiritual warfare. And you know what he did to open his sermon? He drove a tank, not a pretend tank, a U.S. Army tank, to the stage of his church. He had a huge church, got out of the tank and preached from the tank. I remember watching that going, first of all, where do you get a tank? He's got to have some general in his church that probably made arrangements for that. And then every, you know, the next Sunday he continued, he wore army fatigues and he preached about spiritual warfare. A couple of months later, he coincided his sermons with Shark Week. For some reason, he created a series of sermons that had something to do with sharks. I don't remember how he did it. And above the ceiling of the church was a life-size great white shark just dangling from the ceiling. And again, I don't know where he got that, maybe Universal Studios or this, that, or the other. And then a couple of weeks later, he had a sermon called You Are a Ferrari. You Are a Ferrari. And literally drove a Ferrari into the stage of the church, got out of the Ferrari and preached from there. And I remember listening to that and watching that going, boy, for $0, you could do a simple sermon out of a Bible that you've owned for years not have to pay for all these props and just preach the truth, and whoever listens, listens. It's not my job to force you to listen. If you want to walk out on my sermon, that's no loss to me. But do we really need to do all these things in order to capture an audience, or is the truth enough? Is the truth enough? I can't even imagine having a council meeting in this church and asking people like Sheldon and Michael and Vanjie and, you know, and all the other leaders, can we find a tank for this Sunday? It's so unimaginable for me. It's just outside the, it's sort of this, the realm of how I think. Because my job is not to get you to like what I say. My job is just to say it. And if you listen, good. If you don't listen, then I've done my part. And Paul warned Timothy, you will be tempted sometimes to alter what you're going to say and to adapt your message to appeal to a wider audience, but don't fall for it. Because that is a never-ending trap. Because just when you think you've got them, they will push the boundaries and push the boundaries and push the boundaries. And before you know it, it's not anymore about sharks and tanks and Ferraris. It's about changing your whole perspective and your whole purpose, that you no longer are what God called you to be. You've completely changed. He said, people will look for preachers who will say what they want to hear. Isn't that such a perfect description of today? If you listen to YouTube preachers and they start talking about something you don't like, you just have to go to the next channel and the next channel and the next channel until you find someone that agrees with you. By the way, people do that all the time, right? You know, when people come to me for counseling and they don't like what I say, they'll just look for another person to counsel with until they find the counselor who will say something that they agree with, and then they'll come back to me and say, see, Pastor Ed, this counselor agrees with me. You were wrong. Because we have what? Itching ears. We're not seekers of truth. We're seekers of people who will approve our predetermined choices, whether they're right or wrong. Can you imagine that was true 2,000 years ago? How much more true is it today? And so he goes on to say this, there will those who will turn away from the truth, they will wander off into myths. But as for you, Timothy, always be sober-minded, endure suffering, do the work of an evangelist, fulfill your ministry. That's it. You don't have to do this, that, or the other. You just do your work because you are a shepherd. You know what's interesting about the life of Jesus? It's not only what he did, but what he did not do. Jesus only did three things while he walked this earth as a minister. He preached the gospel, he taught messages on the kingdom, and he healed people. That's it. Whenever you see Jesus in the Bible, he's doing one of those three things. He's preaching, he's teaching, or he's healing. What did he not do? He never wrote a book. He never built a large auditorium. He never did a world tour. He didn't do a lot of the things that we consider today necessary for ministry success. All he did is he preached the gospel, he taught principles of the kingdom, and he healed people when they were sick. So focused, so simple. Jesus never really ministered outside the boundaries of Palestine. He didn't have a Mediterranean speaking tour. He's kind of like the Elvis of ministers. You know, Elvis never did a world tour. Elvis always did his concerts here in the U.S. And Jesus was kind of like that. You know, let's stay in this country. Let's Let's build disciples. Let's make disciples. And then they will be the ones to go around the world and proclaim the gospel. But stick to what you know you're called to do. Because the moment you veer from that, you risk living your life outside the will of God. I actually had this conversation with Anna the other day. And Anna's got a way of correcting me without making it sound like she's correcting me. I told Anna, I go, man, I'm almost 54, and I don't have a retirement plan or a pension. So I told Anna, you know, if I had to do it over again, I would have started this church, but I would have gotten a job with a pension. I said, that's what I would do if I could do it all over again. And Anna looked at me and said, but it wouldn't be God's will. Could have. You could choose any path you want, right? You could do anything you want. But the question is, what is God's will? And God's will for me was very simple. To come to the Bay Area, to plant a church, and to make disciples. How I would survive in the Bay Area was none of my business. It was for God to take care of us. How I will survive after retirement is still none of my business. Somebody asked me the other day, Pastor Ed, what's your retirement plan? Prayer. I said, what do you mean? I'm just praying that there's a rich person somewhere in this world whose will has my name on it. And then I'll retire. But you know what? Our concern is simply to do the will of God, to do the work of God, not to worry about tomorrow, not to worry about this and that. Because when has He ever left you anyway? When has He ever forgotten to feed you anyway? When has He failed to provide you with housing anyway? And you think He's going to stop when you turn 60, 65? I don't think so. Our focus is to do the work. So Paul basically says, be a good shepherd. Be a faithful shepherd. Be a good pastor. The second thing he told Timothy is, be faithful until the end. Be faithful until the end. Verse 6. For I am already poured out as a drink offering, and the time of my departure is come. You get that sense? He knows he's dying, right? He goes, this is it. I'm about to die. The time of my departure has come. And then look at what Paul says about himself. He says, I have fought the good fight, I have finished the race, and I have kept the faith. I wonder how many of us would be able to say that on our dying days. But then he says, henceforth God will lay for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award me on that day, but not only me, but to anyone who loves his appearing. So Paul was using himself as an example of how to be focused no matter what, because in the end, our reward is not a pension plan, not a retirement fund. Our plan and our hope is in a future that God prepares for us that he sort of talks about in terms of a crown of righteousness. A crown of righteousness. What is this crown of righteousness? You know, it comes from the word Stephanos. That's why if you know anyone named Stefan or Stephen or Steve, that's what the person's name means, a crown. Stefan. And this is not, there's many words for a crown in the Bible. You know, some crowns are a result of winning a case, you know, and so you get rewarded for that. Some are crowns of judgment. But this particular crown is a reference to the crown that's given to an athlete after they've competed well. In fact, it wasn't even much of a crown in the sense of royalty, as much as it was a token of achievement. In fact, it was made up of laurel leaves. You think to yourself, laurel leaves? That's what you put in adobo, right? You put that in a stew. Why would anyone be proud to put it around their head? It's just a leaf because of what it represents. Just like Olympians today will have a medal around their neck, back in the day, Olympians would get a leaf put on their head. And in terms of price, in terms of value, it might not have been valued much, but when you had it and it was given to you, it represented achievement. Think of what they give you in the office for 10, 20 years of service, a piece of paper, a pen, a paperweight. It's really not much, but it represents your hard work. It represents the things that you do. And that's what Paul is looking forward to. He goes, Christ paid the price for everything, but he's going to give me a crown. It might not be anything more than a leaf, but it represents the fact that I stayed faithful until the end, and only those who are faithful to the end get these. How do you get one of those? How do you get one of those? You don't buy it anywhere. You have to stay the course until the end. You know, if you've ever been to a graduation, did you notice that sometimes people wear different gowns with different colors and different things? If you're a college graduate, it's normally basic black, right? And then if you're graduating with a master's degree, it's basic black, but there's an extra, you know, piece of cloth hanging from your sleeve. That means you're a step above, you know, the undergrad. And then when you work on your doctorate, they start to put stripes on your sleeve, and you wear colors, and your color represents what you worked for. If you're a medical doctor, you wear green because it represents herbs and medicine, right? When you study law, that you wear purple. Tamino, you wore purple, didn't you? Because it represents royalty and politics and rulership. When you're in my field, which is theology, we wear red because it represents the blood of Jesus. We're theologians. We talk about the blood. So I remember one graduation, a student of mine, he wore basic black because he was an undergrad. And I walked in and I had my red stripes and this, that, and the other. And he said, Dr. Misiano, where can I buy one of those? And we had a good laugh about it. And, you know, I put my hand on his shoulder. I go, stuff like this is not about how much you pay. It's how long you stay. These stuff like this is earned. And I encouraged him. And you know that? That same student of mine now has stripes also. Worked hard, went through the process, did the work. And so when we graduate every year, we both wear the same outfit, because he stayed the course, not only for me, but for anyone who will be willing to do the same. Does Pastor Ed have a reward for ministry when I die? I hope so. But not only me, also you. I hope to get the same crown that Paul is looking forward to, but not only me, but may everyone in Bridgepoint also have that crown. But it will only happen if you look forward to his appearing and endure until the very end. You don't get a prize for going halfway and quitting. You don't get a prize for going 90% and quitting. You don't get a prize for even reaching the finish line and quitting before you cross. You only get the prize when you endure until the very end. So he said, stay the course, be faithful. The third thing he tells Timothy is be secure in Christ, not in others. Be secure in Christ, in others. Too much to explain here, so I'll just read it through as much as I can. He said, do your best to come to me. Remember, Timothy is in Ephesus, Paul is in Rome, so they're quite far apart. And he wants to see Timothy before he dies. He knows he's going to be executed. So he says, do your best to come to me soon. For Demas, he was in love with this present world, has deserted me, and he's gone to Thessalonica. Crescens has gone to Galatia. Titus went to Dalmatia. And only Luke is with me. So he has a companion, Luke. We all know Luke, don't we? Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Now, by the way, if you're an old dying man in prison, there would be no better companion than Luke. Because Luke, by profession, is a doctor. He's a surgeon. He's a physician. And isn't it awesome to be old and, you know, sort of wasting away, knowing you're going to die, and there's a doctor next to you just taking care of you? So in the olden days, when you were in prison, you were allowed to have guests, and your guests were allowed to stay with you for as long as you wish. They could hang around the dungeon or the prison, and they would be the one to attend to you, because the Roman guards were not going to attend to you. If you cut yourself, you're on your own. If you stubbed your toe in prison, the guards aren't going to take you to sick bay. You're on your own. So many prisoners would have assistants with them in the prison. They were free men. They could come in and out, but they were free to linger with the prisoner. And Luke was the only one left with him. What happened to Demas? Demas deserted me. That's the bad news. What happened to Crescens? At least Crescens went to Galatia to do ministry. At least Titus went to Dalmatia to do ministry. But whether for good reasons or bad reasons, there's nobody left but Luke. But Luke gets tired too, right? It's hard to care for people. Somebody asked me a while ago, you know, my dad has dementia. And somebody asked me a while ago, how's your dad? And I said, oh, my dad's fine. It's my mom who's tired. Because when you have dementia, it's just a whole new day for you the next day. You don't know how difficult you were the day before. You don't know what bad thing happened yesterday. But the person who cares for you, they're tired. They're the one carrying that burden. So you can imagine Luke's very tired at this point. He's taking care of Paul. He's ministering to Paul. He's healing Paul. So Paul feels that. And then Paul said, Luke is with me, but I want you to get Mark. Bring him with you because Mark is useful to me. We also know Mark. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Now, I'm going to stop here because this needs to be mentioned. Paul was not always kind to Mark. They had a falling apart. So let me take you to the story. In Acts 13 onward, Paul and Barnabas are called to do missions. They're called to plant churches around the world. What we call the first missionary journey, right? Well, Barnabas said, hey, Paul, let's take my nephew Mark. We could use a young man in our travels. Why would you travel, if you were an evangelist, why would you travel with young men? You needed somebody to carry the luggage, to make arrangements with the local hotel, to make sure that they can shop in the market for food. You know, sort of this go-to person, right? In Dumaguete, we call them the ubangelist. There's the evangelist and there's the ubangelist. Uban means to accompany, right? So Mark is their evangelist. He's not the evangelist, but he is the companion to the evangelist. So can you imagine, they said, hey, Mark, want to travel? Sure, uncle, where? Around the world, around the Mediterranean. And Mark's like, finally, I'm going to leave home, right? Mark's excited. But halfway through the journey, Mark realized, this is hard work. You know, Paul is always telling me to do this. Barnabas is always telling me to do that. Purutos. Right? Always telling me what to do. So halfway through the journey, Mark abandons them, goes back home. Paul and Barnabas continue their missionary journey, come back to Antioch. They regroup, they debrief, and Paul said, we need to do a second journey. Barnabas says, cool, let's take Mark. Paul says, uh-uh. You see what he did to us the last time? Halfway through, he never finished his mission. Halfway through, he abandoned us. Halfway through, now I have to carry my own luggage. Barnabas says, no, he's young, he'll learn. Paul said, no, I have no patience for people like that. So Paul and Barnabas had their first LQ, their lover's quarrel. Let's take Mark. No, I don't want Mark. Let's take Mark. He did this to us. And then the conclusion of that is Paul said, okay, This is where he becomes Joe Pesci. Okay. You take Mark, you go where you want. I'll do the journey with other young trainees. And that's what happened. Paul and Barnabas parted ways, and they ended up doing separate missions. That's the last time we saw Paul share his opinion about Mark. He did not like Mark. And yet in his last letter, he said, Bring Mark. He is useful to me. Oh. Now, a couple of things happened. Paul had a change of heart, but at the same time, I'm sure Mark matured, right? Matured enough that he was able to write one of the books of the Bible. So Paul realized that sometimes you just need to give people time. Is there someone in your life right now you can't stand? I'll give you 15 seconds. Who's that one person that when they come to your mind, the lines on your forehead start to... Who's that one person you don't want in your house this Thanksgiving? Who's that one person that if you know they're going to be in this gathering, you don't want to be there? Maybe that's Mark to you. Maybe you just need to give them time. Maybe they're annoying right now. Maybe they're hard to deal with right now. But maybe we should be more like a Barnabas and say, let's give him a chance. He's going to grow up. He's just a boy. One day he'll grow up. Let's be patient. And thank God for Barnabas. Barnabas was the great encourager of the New Testament. And I think it was because of Barnabas that Mark matured, because Barnabas gave him a chance. In fact, I'm willing to guess that Barnabas gave him many chances. But it came to the point that when it came time to do ministry, Mark rose to the occasion. And in fact, of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, we believe that Mark was the first gospel of the four ever written. He was the first to put it all in writing, and all the other guys kind of based their stories on him. That's what can happen when you're patient with someone. Allow them to grow, and in time, God will cause them to flourish. And it came to the point where Paul said, in my dying day, you know who I want next to me aside from you, Timothy? I want Mark, the guy that I couldn't stand a couple of years ago, the guy I wouldn't take with me to missions because he just irritated me. That's the one I want to die with. If I'm going to die, I want Timothy on one side, I want Mark on the other side. That's how I want to leave this world. That's a wonderful story, isn't it? And by the way, if no one in your life is a Mark, then you're Mark. You're the one that's annoying. It's just like when I moved to my new neighborhood in Union City, word got out, there's a weirdo in our street. I looked everywhere. I didn't see any weirdos. And Anna said, ikaw yun. That's you. I go, okay. But I had to pause there. I love. It's just one line, but it's so powerful. Then he went on to say this. Tychicus I have sent to Carpus at Troas. Also the books, and above all, I want you to bring with me the parchments. And the cloak that I left, please bring that with you. So he's asking for three things. Winter is coming. So he said, Timothy, I left my coat in Troas. Can you please pass Troas, bring it to me? And then please collect my books. And don't forget my parchments. Isn't that interesting? What would you ask for on your final days? If somebody can bring you things, what would you want somebody to bring? By the way, the fact that Paul had Timothy take a detour to pick up his coat to bring to Rome shows you how rare coats were back then, right? If this was you, it's like, oh, my coat is in North Carolina, but I have 12 more. right? That's us. Who cares that you lost one coat? But in those days, coats were so rare that the only one you had was the only one you would rely on. That's why when the Bible says, if somebody asks for your coat, give it. To us, that's nothing, right? Okay, here's a coat. But in the first century, that means you're giving everything. You're giving the only thing that's going to keep you warm. And you're going to give it to someone who needs it more. He says, bring the coat. He said, bring the books. What are these books? Probably his copies of sacred writings. Probably, you know, the bulk of his library. And then the parchments. What are these parchments? It could be a combination of stuff that other apostles had written or even some of his own writings that needs to be collected. And eventually they'll be collected by other believers and they'll be put in a book called the Bible someday. Paul said, I need that. I need all that stuff. Come soon. And then he says, beware of Alexander the coppersmith who did me great harm. The Lord will repay him according to what he did. He strongly opposed our message. And then verse 16 is very important. He said, at my first defense, the first time he was in prison, no one came to stand by me. Everyone deserted me. May it not be charged against them. But the Lord stood by me and strengthened me. This is a lesson he's going to tell Timothy. There will be times in ministry where you will feel alone. There will be times in life and ministry where you will feel alone. In fact, even the people you think will never desert you may end up doing so. But where was his assurance? He says, but the Lord was always with me. So when you trust in men and people, you will be disappointed. But when you trust in the Lord, you will not be. So Paul is telling Timothy, look, Timothy, I love Ephesus, I love the Ephesians, but don't put your trust in them. Love them, minister to them, but understand that your hope is in God alone. Because even the most loving, even the most faithful, even the most reliable people under a certain circumstance may end up not being there for you. And that should not be a reason to quit ministry. Because as long as the Lord is with you. I've been asked this question many times. Pastor Ed, have you ever felt Bridgepoint has abandoned you? The answer is no. But objectively, no. Bridgepoint has always taken care of me. But subjectively, in times of loneliness in my life, I have felt alone as a pastor. And this is not against you as the church, because you've always been there for me and my family. But I think the enemy has such an ability to cover people from you that you feel alone in ministry. And there were times when I didn't even know who I could count on. I couldn't even be sure that my family would be there for me. It really came to that point. And I think I've told you, in my 30 years in this church, I've tried to quit 5 or 6 times. It's just, you know, it's just a fact of life. It's just a fact of ministry. Sometimes you just don't want to be there anymore. But then what keeps you going is the idea that, number one, God never leaves you. And number two, the call does not change based on the environment. Right? When you feel supported, you preach. When you don't feel supported, you preach. When you feel supported, you visit people in hospitals. When you don't feel supported, you visit people in hospitals. The work does not change just because you think the environment has. There has to be a consistency. You find your niche, you find your place, and you stick to it. And I've told this story many times. There was a guy in the wharf, Fisherman's Wharf. He's not there anymore for some reason. But when I came in 1992, I would walk by the wharf, and the corner, just a little outside of the wharf, there's a guy there. He's got his hat where you can pay him, and he's playing guitar. That's his gig. But this was the most unusual street musician I've ever seen in my life. You know why? All he played was one chord. All day. Stick to it. I think it was a C major. He's just going to stand there and go, jing ting 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 ting. And then you think he's going to shift, right? Jing ting 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 ting. All day. You're waiting for him to at least go to F or G or at least do an A minor. But he's in C. He's like, jing ting ting ting. All day. So finally, someone in the crowd had the boldness to kind of say to him, dude, is that all you play? Don't you know any other chords? He goes, the other musicians, they play like riffs and things and songs, and they're always playing around with chord patterns. You know what he said? I'll never forget this. He didn't stop all playing. He says, you know what? All those musicians out there, ching, 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 they're still looking for it. Ching, ching, ching. But as for me, ching, 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 I found it. Ching, 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 ching. That was his shtick. He found it. He found it. Why try anything else? He found it. I love that. If we can be that, right? Find what God designed you for, why he put you on this earth. Don't compare yourself to other people. Stick with the plan. He found it. Why mess up a good thing? People were putting money. Why make the effort unnecessarily? But it kind of reminds me of Paul. He's like, I could have done many other things, but this was the call, right? And when no one else was there, God was there. And so, Timothy, I want you to do the same thing. Now, it seems like he ended his letter here by saying, the Lord rescued me from every evil deed and bring me safely into the heavenly kingdom. To him be glory forever and ever. Amen. End of the letter, right? But wait, there's more. I think he realized, oh, I still have space. And so he wrote a couple more lines. He goes, well, I still have this space. I'm going to write something else. This is the equivalent of a PS, a postscript, right? In verse 19 to 22, his postscript was to tell Timothy, be encouraged because you're not alone. And then he says this, greet Prisca and Aquila. By the way, Prisca is sort of the nickname of a woman by the name of Priscilla. In Corinthians, Paul refers to them as Priscilla and Aquila, but here he calls her Prisca and Aquila. So, it's more of a nickname thing. And you know what's interesting about this name? Priscilla and Aquila were a husband and wife team who were ministering in the first century, visiting a lot of the churches that Paul had visited and doing follow-up work. They would visit this church, that church. You know what's the most fascinating thing to me about this? The couple is called Priscilla and Aquila, not Aquila and Priscilla. Normally in the ancient world, you say the man's name first, then the woman's name, right? It should be Aquila. In fact, most documents would have said Aquila and his wife. They wouldn't even mention the woman. But in all of Paul's letters, he always mentions Priscilla. But not only that, very often he will mention her first. It's Aquila and Priscilla. It's Tamina and Ryan. Right? It's Betsy and Michael. It's the woman's name first, which suggests to me that although they were a ministering couple, Priscilla was the one who took the lead. She was the dominant minister, and the husband was her assistant. And that would have been rare in the first century, right? Because it was a man's world. And normally the top billing would be the man. The wife would either be mentioned or just alluded to. But not here. Paul said, no, Priscilla, Prisca, she's the one. She's the one who is responsible for a lot of these things. And then he says, there's the household of Onesiphorus. They greet you as well. Erastus, he remained in Corinth. And I left Trophimus, who was ill at Miletus. And he said, do your best to come before winter. Do your best to come before winter. Of course, for two reasons, right? It's hard to travel once winter hits. But also, he needed his coat. Remember? So come as soon as you can. And he says, Eublus sends you greetings, so as do Prudence, Linus, Claudia, and all the brothers. Oh, Claudia was there. The Lord be with you. Grace be with you. Of all the names that are mentioned here, there's an interesting one, Linus. Linus. He's a friend of Charlie. This Linus, if in Roman Catholic tradition, Peter is considered the first pope, right? The first bishop of Rome. The second pope is Linus. That's him. Now, of course, historically, no one is ever called a pope in the first three centuries. It wouldn't be after, like, during the time of Constantine that they started using the term papa or pope for the bishop of Rome. But if Peter was indeed the bishop of Rome, and that's still to be confirmed, we do know that Linus is the one who succeeded him. And here, he's just one of many workers that Paul commends. And it's another reminder that in the beginning, you might just be one of many, but you never know what God's plan for you is. You might someday be the Bishop of California, right? Or the apostle to Africa or to Asia. Nobody knows what God has planned for you, but you just have to stick with it. So that's the end of his letter. Paul closes it, seals it, and he says, that's the last thing I will ever write before I die, and sends it to Timothy. We don't know what happened. We don't know if Timothy made it in time. We don't know if Timothy was able to grab the coat and the books and the parchment and get to Rome before Paul died. We don't know the rest of the story. But at least we know Paul's heart. By reading this letter, 2 Timothy, we can take the story from the perspective of Paul and say, what did it look like to be a believer in the first century? What did it look like to be a persecuted believer in the first century? What did it look like to be a persecuted believer in the first century that stayed faithful until the end? And I think that is the great value of this book or this letter. Because even if we don't know how it ended on Timothy's side, we know that Paul had the closure that he needed because he said, I have finished the course. I've run this race. I've kept the faith. I will have a reward waiting for me. But you know what? So will you if you hang in there. So maybe that's what I'm going to leave you with as we end our series on 2 Timothy. I hope I'll get a reward when my time is done. But more than that, as your pastor, I hope you will too. I hope you get it too. But it will only happen if you stay faithful until the very end. Don't allow the things of this world to rob you of that commitment. Don't let what's changing in the world change what God has already instilled in your heart. Don't let the things of this world distract you from the path that God has laid out for you, because only those who make it till the end will receive this crown of righteousness. And that is my prayer for each and every one of you today. Let us pray. Our God in heaven, we thank you for such a wonderful, even though it is a brief letter, it gives us so much insight into Paul's mind, how he felt, how he thought, how he agonized over so many trials and losses and feeling of abandonment. And yet in all of that, you have given him hope. And in all of that, you have allowed him to instill hope in us. We read this letter 2,000 years later, and we remain encouraged and informed and strengthened. We receive it as Timothy would have received it the first time, as a word of admonition, as an encouragement to go on, and as a reminder to not stray from the faith, but to stay the course. And there might be some of us here today in this building or listening online, and we're so tempted to take a detour. We're so tempted to stop the race. We're so tempted to give it up. But because of this letter, we've been reminded to stay faithful until the end, because there awaits for us a crown of righteousness. And the greatest reward is to be with a Savior that gave his life for me and to spend eternity with him forever. And so, Father, I pray for all my brothers and sisters that are listening to the sound of my voice today. I pray that for those who are discouraged and disheartened, that they might be filled with renewed hope and strength. I pray that for those who are tired in their bodies might experience a renewed zest for life. I pray that those who are in darkness will hang in there long enough to see the light. And for all of us to be faithful and to be found faithful until the very end, all for the glory of Christ. And let it begin today in my life. Use me, fill me, grant to me everything I need to fulfill your will each and every day. And I rely on your Holy Spirit to make me strong in this commitment and your word to guide my path. I thank you for all of these things. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Thank you so much for listening to the word today, for participating in a time of worship. And before we let you go, we'd like to give you an opportunity to respond to God in an act of generosity and giving. The two ways that you can give: one is you can physically give an offering here at the church. There is an envelope in a pew pocket in front of you. Our ushers are coming and they will receive your gifts in a few moments. Or if you prefer, whether you're online or even in the church, you can give electronically by opening your devices and going to your apps for Zelle, Venmo, Pop Money, or just open your browser and go straight to the church website, bridgepointcc.com. Look at the menu, click on Give, and then you'll be directed to a secure site to give. However you wish to give today, let me say ahead of time, we are grateful for your faithfulness and your generosity. You are the reason this ministry has stayed the course for as long as it has, and you will continue to be the reason it will go on for as long as God would have us. So thank you. Our ushers are coming at this time to receive your gifts.
That goes on. Good morning, church. I guess if Paul was coming up, calling me up here, he'd say this is Beth's husband, so also known as Chuck. So I heard it earlier, November, the time of thanks. Important to keep that in mind. Generally, when I'm feeling sorry for myself and on the pity pot, it's because I've lost a lot of the gratitude in perspective to realize how good I have it and to be blessed with the people around me who I really appreciate and have gratitude for. So good reminder of the month of November to keep that in mind. So let's bow our heads for the giving we received today. God, thank you for allowing us to meet here and to remember the thanks we have for one another and for the church. Please take these offerings and put it to best use so others can be grateful and appreciative of those around them. Thank you. Please be with us and just keep on giving and let us receive your gifts as well. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, everyone. That was lovely, Brother Chuck. And this concludes our service. Please join us in singing one more song. And remember to go and love and serve the Lord.